Hello, thank you so much for joining us. A very warm welcome to Grant Thornton's Look at the Year Ahead. My name is Kate Silverton. I'm delighted to be here with you. Thank you for joining us today. The team will join me shortly. I'm going to be asking them how they think we can best embrace, tackle the risks and the challenges that this year might present, and also to grasp the opportunities and navigate the opportunities that we're going to see in 2022. The past 24 months unquestionably have seen a vast power shift. I think it's changed everything for business, for leaders, for employees. So now, as the dust starts to settle, the aim of this panel debate today is really to look at where we can start to have some clarity amid that uncertainty that we've seen. We will begin with an economic update, summarising the latest research for you with some really practical guidance from the panel, covering what you need to know as we now enter this new period then for 2022. I mean, there's little question that we are at a critical moment, and I'll be asking the panel how leaders can really assess the agility, your organisations, and understanding whether you have the resilience that I think we're all going to need as we adapt and move ahead and respond to potential future challenges. We're going to be looking at skill shortages, the intensity of adopting environmental targets, reporting, regulation, diversity, inclusion, and of course, how to respond to potential future world and economic events. In short, what 2022 is going to bring, both in terms of opportunities and those risks then to navigate. I want to make the session as interactive as possible, so I'm going to need you here to interact with us with your questions. This is your time, and for those of you who might have been here at the panel debate that we had at the end of last year, you'll know that we had a lot of questions which I was able to pose to the panel. So I intend to do the same today, so do send them in. You can send them in by joining Slido via the details that will come up on the screen. I will cover as many as I can live, and they will also be addressed. If you want to keep sending them, they'll be addressed as well thereafter. If you would like to direct one of your questions to a particular individual on the panel, then I will ask you just to add their name to the question. And with that, I think we should introduce our panel more formally and ask them to introduce themselves. Alan, I'm going to start with you. A formal introduction and then maybe a little bit of colour, if you will. I think it's just nice. We've had such a weird old time that sometimes it's just quite nice to get a grasp on, you know, what else? What keeps you going outside of work? What are the things that you enjoy? So I'm going to ask everyone the same question, but let's start with a formal introduction.
Perfect. Thanks, Kate, and good morning. My name is Alan Dale. I lead the business consulting practice at Grant Thornton, and that's a practice that deals with all kinds of change, and we'll bring alive what some of that change looks and feels like in the year ahead. In terms of the fun facts, so probably two things. One, I'm not an accountant. And how scary is it being not an accountant in a firm of 5,000 accountants? But about me, I once ran the 100 in 11.1 as seconds, but that was a long time ago.
Are you still running?
No, I walk these days. The hips and the knees.
I'm with you. Jen.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Jen Barnett. I work in inclusion, diversity and health, and I really enjoy horse riding, and probably shouldn't anymore because I don't think I'm as good as it as I once was. And I'm also very keen psychologist, like to read lots about the brain, very interested in neuroscience, so very much looking forward to this morning.
Lovely. Thanks, Jen. And Sonia?
So I'm Sonia Shah, and I'm leading on environmental, social and governance, along on, with a particular focus also on climate risk in the financial services practice at Grant Thornton. And yes, I am an accountant, you know, so I'm very proudly to say so. But alongside with that, I think another side of me is I'm hugely passionate about traveling to very remote parts of the world. And through that, I actually have become quite a bit involved with getting myself into photojournalism by integrating with a lot of local and indigenous communities in the places I visit.
Wow. So. Give us one example of one of the most remote places that you've been.
So I've been to the north and northwest frontier out in Pakistan and in areas where I had to get special insurance cover as well. But meeting, for example, the tribes in the Kailash Valley, which actually are preserving their culture and seeing how they're able to survive in the environments they're in.
And do you know what's interesting, just bringing it into the forum for today, and I'm really interested in this, is what we can learn actually from our more ancient cultures, which we all have, we were all once part of. And when we talk about well-being and living actually more as a community, talking less about me and more about we, what might we learn? So I might ask you to sort of a few reflections in that regard, because
Absolutely.
It's something I'm also very interested in. Thank you very much. Dave, let's come to you now.
Thank you, Kate. So I'm Dave Dunkley. I'm the CEO of Grant Thornton here in the UK. So I was nervous saying these fun facts, and I thought that Al had set the bar so low in terms of his fun facts, not being an accountant. And then Sonia spoke. So I'm not going to be anywhere near as fun as Sonia, but the fact I often use is I failed to get into Grant Thornton's graduate recruitment scheme. Many years ago, I know, given the grey hair, but I failed. But actually, I've come through now, and I'm really proud to be CEO.
Well, that's one, and that's actually a really good story. I talked to my daughter at bedtime just recently about resilience and how many times I'd failed to get the job that I really wanted. And it's always good to be reminded that it doesn't stop there. So maybe that's a point we can pick up. We're going to obviously be expanding the conversation, looking at the opportunities for growth, really practical things that we all might consider as leaders, talking about attracting and retaining talent, business resilience, of course, and agility, and compliance with an ever-changing regulation. So how do we plan for the year ahead? Well, I think we should start by looking back at where we've been, what we can now expect in terms of economic updates and predictions. So let's take a look.
. 2021 was a mixed year for the UK economy, with government support softening the blow from COVID-19. Remarkable growth in Q2 slowed in the months after, with significant sectoral variations. The economy is expected to have grown by around 7%, completing its recovery from COVID-19 in the fourth quarter. Measures introduced to protect jobs have so far proved successful, with unemployment remaining low, finishing around 4.2%, below the worst-case predictions at the start of the year. Inflation soared, ending the year over 5%. The highest level in decades. 2022 looks set to be another challenging year. The economy is predicted to grow between 4 and 6%, the fastest growth in the G7, before slowing to more moderate levels in the following years. Positive growth forecasts are, however, tempered by a growing number of headwinds. The emergence of the Omicron variant at the end of last year brought significant uncertainty. But as the health implications become clearer, the outlook has brightened once again. The government has avoided further lockdowns and looks set to do so in the future, with the narrative moving to living with COVID. If this continues, the impact of Omicron on the UK economy should be limited. The international picture is more complicated, with different economies adopting different approaches in response. This will have knock-on effects for businesses with international footprints. A number of factors combined to drive prices higher in 2021, and we expect this pressure to be maintained. The Bank of England has revised inflation expectations upwards, with their forecast now for highs of 6% in spring 2022. This will put pressure on interest rates, but we do not expect large moves this year. The government is banking on inflation coming into line through Bank of England measures, but also through productivity rises mitigating against a wage price spiral. Despite this, early signs are that productivity increases and interest rate rises are unlikely to be the mitigation, and we may be in for a longer period of inflation above the Bank of England's 2% target. Rising inflation is driven by and will cause a number of key issues. The cost of doing business looks set to increase further, with supply chain bottlenecks, shortage of raw materials, and rising energy costs all remaining as challenges, as well as growing pressure on wages. Companies also face a growing burden of red tape. As Brexit challenges continue to filter through, businesses will face fresh administration hurdles, such as the implementation of full border controls by HMRC. We can also expect new legislation on areas such as audit reform, reporting requirements, and further measures to deliver newly agreed goals on climate change, all of which will add cost. Attracting and retaining the skills businesses need will continue to be a challenge in 2022. Although unemployment remains around 4%, the number of vacancies reported has reached record highs, with sluggish response of UK labour supply relative to strong labour demand suggesting lower matching efficiency. This looks set to continue the upward pressure on wages alongside general inflationary impacts. Over the past 18 months, households have accumulated over £150 billion in excess savings. The extent to which this money is spent in 2022 will be critical to business and economic growth. As the cost of living increases and the squeeze on living standards continues, the willingness of consumers to spend these savings may fall. Over 2 years on from a resounding election victory, the government's focus now turns to winning the next one. So far, they have been forced to respond to events, but as the next general election comes into view, they will seek to use their majority to prioritise manifesto commitments before the UK returns to the polls. 2022 offers an opportunity for them to focus on priority areas such as levelling up and health and social care reform. Look out for big policy announcements, new legislation, tax changes, and leadership challenges as the Conservatives seek to reverse current polling trends.
A lot of ground covered there, many points which I'm sure we'll all be picking up on, but just that last point, Dave, many challenges, but as we know, that within a crisis, within challenge, there is always going to be opportunity. Absolutely. For the right business, for the right leaders. So let's delve into that if we can.
Okay, shall I start with a few reflections on perhaps on 2021, which I think it's always a good context before we look forward. So we look at 2021 for us, and I'll try not to be too internal, but I think it's a good starting position. It was incredibly successful, and the measures on which we look at are around the quality of the work we do, engagement of our people, and financial measures as well. So if I start with quality, we had a big step change in how the firm is perceived, which is an important strategic driver for us. We had an incredibly engaged workforce, notwithstanding how difficult a time and difficult working environment they had. And I'll touch on financials. We're going to report some numbers in March, just closed the year end. We'll have double-digit growth, which is fantastic. And you look at why we had double-digit growth, and I think we had success across the business, but a real standout for us, which goes to the opportunity that we'll talk about shortly, is our M&A business, our transactions business, had an unprecedented journey. Look at the reasons why behind that, some of them we saw in the video, in terms of the change of business behaviour. People in 2020, including us, took a more conservative strategy to expansion for very understandable reasons, given the uncertainty, and perhaps managed their business more for cash. So there was a backlog of transactions, there's a storage up of cash, and of course Brexit has happened. So we are seeing a lot of money coming into the UK, which is driving a lot of activity, which is a good thing for advisors like us, and clearly a great thing for the economy. So it's an overall successful year, but there's a big but. It's come at a cost to our people. Our people are incredibly tired. As you said, it's been an extraordinary 24 months. If you look at 2020, I mean, the Prime Minister in England yesterday said, we're back at work. This time last year, it felt really dark and long, and we're going through one of our busiest times. So our people have struggled with that in difficult environments, and we'll talk about it. There is a war for talent. Our industry is like no different to any other. We have some challenges as an industry, which reflected in our business. So getting the right people in our business is really, really important. And that is something which is going to be a real driver as we move into 2022. So if I look a little bit at 2022, one of our biggest aims is to continue that growth trajectory in a more sustainable way. And when I talk about sustainability, it's not just the climatic impact, which is really, really important we'll touch on, but how can we continue that growth momentum with such a tired resource, which is our people. We are a people business. So item number one on our agenda is attracting and retaining the right talent, which probably is no surprise to anybody. And there's an element of that, how you do that is reward, but that's not
The fundamental for us is the environment we give people. So that's a combination of a physical environment. Yeah, thank you. We can get back in the office and get back to what we used to, get those interactions, which is a massive part. And we know a lot of our people want to do that. But it's a cultural environment as well. If you look at back at the 24 months you mentioned, people have been in their rooms plugging into a laptop. And what does it mean that laptop's wired to us? Mm. What is the sense of belonging? What commitment are we giving to our people such that it's something more than just a transactional? It's got to be that sense of belonging. So attracting and retaining the right people with that sense of belonging, giving them the right environment, is really important. We will continue to invest in technology. And part of that links to giving them our people the best environment to work in as we move to a different hybrid way of working. But it's more than that. It's making us more efficient, making us more attractive to clients. So we look the best possible client service in the most efficient way. And the two areas which I know we're going to talk to with Sonia and Jen are the importance of D&I and ESG to that sustainable growth. As a firm, we've invested hugely in D&I in the last 2 years, and it's all been about awareness. And we've perhaps focused more on the I than the D. And I've talked a lot to our team about the concept of everyday inclusion. Everyone at this firm should feel included each and every day. And in 2022 and beyond, it's everyday decisions. So when we're promoting, recruiting, selecting for teams, making sure we've got that mindset that everybody's a part and everybody's got that opportunity. And we need to get our environmental thinking in the same place. I think COP26 is a massive, massive wake-up call to industry, including us. In terms of, do we as a business understand the impact of our day-to-day decisions? I want everyone in our business to be able to speak to our clients in a more educated way. What's the climatic impact of dialing into a meeting as opposed to going to meet a client, as opposed to coming into the office? Because society expects that of us, our clients expect, and go back to our number one driver, people want to be attracted to businesses that take this seriously and have got a really credible plan to get to net zero in a really meaningful and sustainable way. So if I look back, really proud of how we've done 2021, concerned at how tired people are, and that's got to be the forefront of what we're looking at to capture these opportunities in 2022, because unless we've got the right people, those opportunities will pass us by.
Mm. Do you think there's going to be, lots of amazing points there to pick up on, but just on that, I love that you've expressed explicitly this question of tiredness. Because I think you're right, people are exhausted, and being at home is exhausting. You know, we are social beings as human beings, and we thrive, and our energy comes from being around one another. There's been so much, not to mention sort of people being poorly, you know, there's a lot. So do you think we're going to have a bit of from a human perspective, for leaders to recognise and honour that there will need to be a transition? If you think about the announcements that have just been made, there's been no sort of hurrahing in the streets and sort of banners flying. I think everyone's just like, right, okay, so we're now going back to normal. What is normal? And actually, who am I anymore? And I just wonder whether you think, just from a human perspective, whether we need to allow ourselves a little bit of time. We can't hit the ground running because we just don't have the energy.
I think that's right. And you look, it's one of the best things we did in 2021 was give everybody 2 days, just well-being days over and above what you've done. And it's not massive in the scheme of things, but the appreciation that we're thinking of people was really well received. And I think you used the word normal. What is normal? Mm. The biggest opportunity we've got is to redefine normal. And if you look at how we recruit, we have waves after, like all firms like us, we have waves of people come in September post-university, and we've had a recent cohort of 300 people join in January. The ability now to recreate the experience that lots of other people have had, getting the cohort, the social aspect, the day-to-day development is massive. But when we were open last summer, we were not fully occupied. People are still really nervous. Mm. There are people who've joined this business who've probably never come into an office. Mm. It's a different reality. So I think we've got to dispatch what normal was and redefine it with people, not for them, with them, and recreate the environment that's going to attract and retain them.
Yeah. And before I come to Alan, just to sort of give the reflections from the market, your clients, what you're hearing, what are the main points that you would say are still of concern? Because I'm hearing a lot of optimism. You're clearly sort of looking at it from this big picture perspective. But what would be the main areas of concern for you? What's keeping you up at the moment?
Probably, maybe a boring answer, attracting and retaining people.
Right.
And that environment. And then you look at, perhaps passed over when I talked about what drives people. Reward is important to people. The cost of living is going up at a rate as a generation have never seen. Mm. There might be borrowing costs going up later in the year that most predictions are at a rate people have never seen.
And the other thing, if people are going to start coming back to the office, they're going to spend more money commuting. So that's one element that we've got to get right, but more than that is that environment.
Mm.
And I want us to be a place that attracts people for reasons which are brilliant for them. So they come here to grow and thrive and do some brilliant client work. And if we can do that, everything else will fall in place. Yeah. That's such a big foundational layer for
we will dive into that, I think, absolutely, because you're right. But Alan, just from your perspective then, in terms of how this is all being mirrored in the market, what are you seeing?
We're probably seeing a lot of the same themes. So in terms of, we do a survey every 6 months of our clients and the markets in the UK and on a global scale. And we also clearly speak to a lot of leadership teams across a whole host of businesses, across a whole host of sectors, for profit and not for profit. And so I'll cover some of the stats, even though I'm not an accountant, I'll go through a few stats. But also, what are people really starting to do and focus and spend their time on as leaders? And what are the kind of things that they feel they've got to face into in the year ahead? In terms of what does the survey say and what do our clients say, is that actually, after 2 years of what's felt really hard work, really hard time, a real sense of confidence in the year ahead. So 69% of leaders are really up for what the market, what their employees, what their customers are going to be doing in the year ahead. And that mindset's a really important mindset shift, because if you think about the last year or two, how mindset has driven behavior, has driven actions, actually that mindset's a really important one. And that links to two-thirds of companies expect to make more profit this year than in the year just gone. And what's going to drive that? There is a big theme of international expansion. Now, that's not a surprise, given Brexit and given market status, but the importance is at an all-time high of how organisations based in the UK are seeing their market beyond the borders of the UK. We will come back a bit to whether they have the skills to do that, because that is going to be a bit of a challenge. In terms of investment, people are expecting to invest far more this year than their last year and in the years gone. And three core themes, and Dave picked up on a few of those. Transactions. There is an awful lot going on in terms of acquiring, disposing. We think it's going to be a very hot market in the year ahead. Investment in people, both retaining, and that's not a small ask, and in attracting the right talent. And technology is that people wanting to do long-term investment around technology to set some of those foundations for growth. But people do see a lot of challenge in the market ahead. And I'll come back to what some of those things are in the one-to-one chats we've had. In terms of wage inflation, we've all seen that. And almost all people surveyed said that they're going to pay their people more. But only a third said it would be at the level of inflation or above, which is actually quite a surprising thing given the state of the war on talent here. So people are starting to think around what can they do beyond just pure pay. And then we asked leaders, how did you perform in the year gone? And so there were certain things they felt they did well and certain things that weren't quite as strong. So things that were well, comms, I think all the businesses we've spoken to and the employees really rated the way that leaders were open, transparent and engaged. And I think it made a real difference to how people got through this. And the ability of leaders to make decisions and to pivot fast. Where are they less strong and where do they feel they're less strong in the year ahead? The one resounding one was the skills to go into markets outside of the UK. So if that's a big driver of growth and a big driver of the confidence in the year ahead, then actually, do they have the skills as a leadership team to do that? So when we've spoken to people, what have the leadership teams said then? So beyond the survey and the stats, what have they said? They mirror a lot of the same themes. So they believe this year is less uncertain, but that the headwinds are really strong. So the tail end for this winter, at least, are Brexit, and the stats look good. Sorry, of a COVID. We have Brexit and the red tape starting to bite. We have people expanding. We have inflation. We have interest rates. We have the war for talent. We have skills shortage. There's strangely a level of confidence about those things, because the first time in 2 years, these are known knowns. Mm. And people feel they can really start to plan for this. So it's giving people the confidence to actually think more long-term and set some of those foundations for growth, investing in key people, investing in acquiring firms, looking at the ops model, looking at their culture. And also we've got a theme we saw a lot last year is that people are looking at their business, what's core to their business and what's not. And in terms of from a transactions perspective, what's non-core and its value is really high in the transactions market is actually taking the bold decision to dispose of certain assets and reinvest that in key parts of the business. And I think the thing that came through most, though, in all the chats we've had is something Dave picked up on before, is the commercial imperative of ESG and inclusion and diversity as part of that. The time for words has stopped. I think Dave's right. I think inclusion and diversity, I think as a country, I think we are more mature in our thinking, but still so far to go. Around the environmental agenda, I think we and all the companies I speak to are just at the start. And why has this got to move from warm words into real action, apart from the moral and the ethical standpoint? There's a commercial driver for that line in the sand. Stakeholders to any organisation are now making it very important to them, whether it's the owners, consumers, the customers, suppliers, banks in terms of lending criteria, and employees in terms of where they choose to go. This is a very hot market for skills, and people are really choosing where they work, not just based on pay, but on the purpose, the values, and the sustainability of a business. And those businesses who get that thinking right will be able to attract and retain the best people. We still see a very hot market in terms of transactions. The values are still really high. There's a wall of cash, there's a wall of investment. I think that will fuel a great deal of growth in the course of this year. The counter to that, though, is distress across the last year and a half in firms has probably been a lot less than most of us thought at the start of the pandemic. But when we reflect and think about the level of support from the government to firms, that funding has been quite cheap. Actually, that support has been started to be withdrawn. Cost of funding is starting to go up. And even though it's a view that it'll be between 1 and 1.5% at the end of the year, these may start to tip firms into more distress. So again, we'll see firms having to struggle with distress in the course of this year. So if I sum all that up, a level of confidence in the year ahead, some really big things that firms have to face off into, but a will to do that, and the commercial imperative and drivers of ESG.
Thank you very much. There's lots of points to pick up on. We've had a question that's come in. I mean, just reflecting, I had a really brief conversation yesterday, a small accountancy firm talking about distress. And he said, and he deals with very small businesses, but he said a third of those on his books are in distress and actually declaring they're not going to be going on.
Yeah.
And that really brought me up very short. Obviously, just one firm, but a third. Jen, let's just reflect on what Alan's just been saying, because I think looking at this, how we attract and retain people, if it's not going to be about pay, what is it? Owen County Director, I think it's BIE, sorry, this is quite small writing on my screen here, I'm like an old lady peering at it. But one for Jen, with GT focused on getting the right people into the business, how can we look at this through the prism of social mobility? So I've expanded it a little bit, and I'm sure we'll all talk about this, but I just think that's an important thing to bring up as well, isn't it?
It is, and thanks, Owen. That's a great question. We've touched on reward. I think both Dave and Al touched on reward and also on all of the other things we need to be thinking about. I mean, imagine what it's like in the pandemic to be in a one-bedroom flat in the middle of London without any space and having to deal with that for that whole time. It has undoubtedly created some... You know, I don't want to be too dramatic, but some post-traumatic stress with some people. And now we're saying, well, actually, you know, it's going back to normal and it's going to be a change again. So I think there's an awful lot that the pandemic has raised for us in terms of acceleration of the pace of change. I think our people are expecting different things now. So they'll be expecting us to think about and put flexibility at the heart of how businesses operate and what's expected in terms of that social contract. And people have experienced that during the pandemic. They've had more ability to create better social interactions during their working week. And I think that people will want that to continue. And I think the other thing is this expectation that businesses should be relying more on digital integration to support better communications between teams so that we become more efficient and more able to work in a hybrid way. So I definitely think there's going to be a shift in employee expectation beyond reward. And the other aspect of that is the acceleration of inclusion and diversity that we've seen in the last, particularly the last 2 years, and the real link to that in terms of what businesses can do. I talk about moments that matter. So in those moments of matter, it's when are people feeling at their most vulnerable and what do organisations do to respond to that? Mm. So the start of the pandemic was a really good example of that. They look to businesses to lead them in places where they feel vulnerable, and it will be the same now. You know, what are businesses choosing to do to help me to come back and return? We're not returning, are we? We're moving forward into a new way of working, and I think people will be looking at businesses for that. And I think the other thing is that if we're thinking about inclusion, it's, you know, how is trust built with people? It's built through your networks, your feeling of belonging. It's built on what leaders say and the integrity of what they say and also how they act. So if they say flexibility is important, then the way they act around that in terms of putting it in their calendar when they're picking up the kids or actually being able to go for a run at lunchtime or being very visible about the flexibility that they put into their working week is also very important.
Is that going to be easier now? Sorry, go on, Alan.
No, well, I think it's linked to the same point in that one thing we've seen is that the level of trust built between employees and businesses and leaders in the last 2 years has been astounding, quite frankly. We spoke before about how leaders have been more open, transparent, had to pivot, had to say when they don't know things. That's built a greater bond between them and the people who work in the business. And it's this new normal and this line in the sand is that I do think that organisations have a chance now to not go back into the old way of thinking, behaving, leading, and why they come to work. And that's my slight fear, is that those businesses will go back into that moment of how it used to work 2 years ago. Those businesses that will really thrive will understand what's changed, redefine what that works with them, and as Dave says, don't do it to the business, but do it with the business and co-shape it.
That's quite a big ask, isn't it? Because I think it's all been so wobbly and so uncertain and so remote that I don't know, I would have a sense of actually going, can we just have a little bit of order now and can we just all get back in? I'm wondering whether there'll be a bit of a knee jerk, but then it will settle. I know some firms, there's a Durham link between us, and I think it's a Durham app-based bank, recently announced that they'd had a 500% upsurge in applications after they announced they were going to a four-day week with 100% pay. Mm. I wonder whether there's something in that for creating a sense of sort of boundaries around the working week, but actually saying we also are going to honour that we need to maybe think differently. So it gives people enough structure in terms of productivity and coming into the office, but actually we're going to honour 100% pay, but fewer hours. What do you think about that?
It's something we have contemplated. We're not ready for that yet. I think the desire for people to have more flexibility, we 100% embrace. And what is that? About job share, for instance, we haven't done that well in the past. That could be a real game changer for us, our industry and our firm. But I think in terms of the knee jerk, there is a danger you could knee jerk for, we have put some principles and we're calling it a runway in terms of, let's just see how it goes. Let's get people's confidence up, make it all intentional, and maybe in 6 months' time we'll revisit it based on feedback. But it is, we can't tell people, I've got as many people saying, I don't ever want to come in again as I want to come in every day.
That's a challenge, right? So our leaders meant to be nimble and equally to hold that space for everybody, but to make the right decisions for the organisation at the same time.
It's balance of giving people as much empowerment as they can in their own lives, noting that actually for a business like us, we have to deliver great client service. That doesn't mean you have to be in the same place. You can do that from around the globe. So that's a big enabler in itself. But giving people empowerment and trusting people, to Al's point. The biggest thing that happened to me in 2020, I never worked at home a day in my life till March the 16th last year. Mm. The trust I saw in our leaders that we don't have to look at our people to see what they're doing. Mm. They're away and they're delivering for each other, they're delivering for our client. If we capture that trust into what we recreate, we'll get the best bits.
So, as you said, no sort of the warm words have got to translate into action. I want to bring Sonia in because you're nodding at this. I want to talk about ESG, but just on a more reflective, just in terms of what's been said so far.
Sure, and very much like Dave, you know, I was very much an office person, having to, you know, looking forward to coming in every day, because that actually kept my, you know, interacting with your colleagues, interacting with your clients, and I think the presence of having to be there in the office. But I think over the 2 years, how that sort of pattern has changed, even with me, in terms of having the flexibility of what I can deliver, but having the sense of comfort that, yes, we are depending on each other, and somehow, and what I've noticed is there's been a bit more collaboration in how we're all delivering flexibly, but on a timely basis as well. And I think that speaks volume. But going back to Dave and Alan's point as well, is trying to, how do we now look at the new way forward as such? What does it mean? I think initially I was very much, as everyone, 6 weeks will be fine, 3 months will be fine, and 2 years later, this is where we are. Mm. So it's coming into that proposal that, yes, you know, hybrid will prosper, definitely the way forward, but also the ability now to bring that sort of structure and normality back in to where it was.
Yeah. And with some new purposes, ESG being one of them. And I'm going to come back to Alan first of all, because we just want to talk about the talent, and then come back to you, Sonia, in terms of, because people are going to be driving change. Yeah. I want to work. A lot of employees we know are reassessing, what is my purpose? Do I want to be in this organisation actually? Is it serving me in every which way? Because it ain't so much serving me in the wallet anymore. You know, we've got other issues. So coming back to talent, who are going to be the winners in attracting and retaining it, and how might sort of a company's purpose, translating the warm words into action in terms of the big important things that we all need to be considering. So I'm sure for people that is going to be, to attract talent, we need to act on that too.
There is no doubt that in the market we see now across a lot of sectors, pay is driving a lot of people's moves, but it's quite a short-termist view. The thing that will retain people is, we spoke before about people wanting more structure and more rules. I do wonder if that's counter to inclusion. Actually, I think through that trust thing we've learned for those employees and for businesses, because not all can work from home, because shop floor and production, you can't. But where you can, what I'm seeing from my clients is setting less rules,
So not having no rules at all, but having clear expectation of what the role is, the ability to do that in a way that allows you to do things outside of work, while actually starting to build back in that really important time with people and teams and face-to-face contact. Just walking through London today for the first time since December felt fantastic. Mm. I got a real buzz from that and a real lift. And so I do think purpose and culture are really important. I think the ways of working that come back in and the way we treat people around inclusion and diversity, I actually think they're going to be the anchor points that help retain our best people.
Okay, we've got quite a few questions coming in. I'm just going to ask if I can have the time put up, please, because I want to just keep an eye on the time, if I can have my clock. Thank you very much. Or a clock put on, thank you. So we've got an anonymous one come in, just picking up, because we'll turn now, Sonia, to ESG and what Alan's just been saying. I believe we'll see a continued increase in ESG scrutiny around action over words through 2022. Will Grant Thornton focus on ESG vis-a-vis client base?
I'll take the question in terms of client base and how the market's actually changing, and lead that on to Dave in terms of how we as Grant Thornton are approaching sustainability. But I actually, when we first went into lockdown, it was the conversations around particularly climate had started to take shape quite a bit, primarily driven through the UK regulation in the financial services sector. And through 2020, and particularly in 2021, the type of conversations I started having with clients really, really took off on a massive scale. Alongside with that, where tons of regulations or, proposed regulations started coming in. And the discussion of what I look at 2021 is primarily the year of ESG, where the type of conversations, the topics which are coming on the table really started to get varied. But what we really started to see is how all the companies, particularly at the board and the C-suite level, are sitting on the table and bringing in this topic of sustainability in practically every meeting they're actually having. Mm. Because what they were starting to actually see is that these are questions coming from, of course, we had COP26, which came in November, a lot of media attention being placed over there, but we also had, regulations starting to creep in, and also, the various stakeholders. So ranging from the investors of what we're talking about, the different types of transactions activity, what people are looking at. You have also your employers and even your potential employees are now starting to say, what does your firm do on sustainability as being one of the key points on their decisions? You have customer patterns of behavior, buying patterns changing quite a bit. And one of the most important groups which came up, which we really noticed in 2021, was activists, and significantly younger activists. Mm. So all these factors really came into horn when companies are having these discussions, irrespective of size. It's not just the larger companies, but even the smaller niche companies are actually bringing this on the table for discussion. So,
and it's got to go more than discussion, hasn't it?
It's getting more than discussion where companies actually are. The amount of companies which are now starting to print out either mentioning sustainability in their annual reports or sustainability statements specifically coming out.
Where's the tangible, though? What are the practical things that companies need to be considering and doing in order to comply with regulations and the expectations of those
So I think what it needs to be done is first think about what does sustainability mean for you as a firm. Sustainability is very different for every firm, what it represents. And within that, we talk about this word ESG, the acronym, where they need to think about environmental, social, and governance within their whole framework. And that takes time. That takes time to think through what does it really mean to us. But some of the companies which I deal with, actually, when they've come up with a plan on this, they're now starting to think, okay, how do we actually now start to embed this? And once they've decided what is key, what is the purpose of our firm, and what actually is our product and services, and where do we now still want to be with those product and services? Is there anything we want to leave, come out of? And once it's decided, it's then coming up with your whole business strategy. And one of the biggest shifts is actually business strategies and operating models of firms. That's a huge, huge impact of what you've been doing for decades, actually now changing today. And alongside with that is then setting up your whole framework around which we're helping firms on
doing it. So what's Grant Thornton doing? That was the question, particularly around the client base.
About the client, so there's the two things. I've talked a little bit about us, but there is, like, at the interim, we are waiting to see what government reforms come out in terms of what's going to be mandated on us, in terms of the assurance we give to investors in the pronouncements companies make. Every commentator thinks that there is going to be some more work for us to do in terms of giving people trust that they can rely on the statements that are made. And of course, we're ready to do that, but we will wait and see what comes in the regulations. In terms of us, the science-based target initiatives came out, redefined as a new statement in October. So we're just going back and looking at our own footprint and making sure what we've got is backed by the science-based target initiatives, because what we want to do is not make pronouncements which have been changed by the clarity which those regulations are given. The single, perhaps repetition, but no apologies for it, the single biggest thing we've got to do is education. I think if you look at the E of ESG, the environmental impact we have, on the face of it, it's not big. We're accountants, but we're sat in the building, it's heated, et cetera, et cetera. We are part of an international organisation. We fly around. So it's understanding what's scope one, what's scope two. But the real discretion is in the scope three emissions. I want all of our people to know on a day-to-day basis what they're doing. And that's something which has really accelerated in the last 2 or 3 months. Because if we can get there, we'll be in a really strong place. But the broader bits of sustainability and perhaps links to the social mobility question, which was the one before, doing a huge amount of work to attract different sorts of people into our business, which goes to sustainability as well. That goes to people like refugees, done a huge amount of work with refugees, looking at different schools.
Can you give examples around that? Because that's really nice to...
Perhaps I'd get Jen to pick up on the refugee one in a second, but going to different organisations, different schools, working with industries like Access Accounting to give people basic financial knowledge, perhaps that they haven't got before. Mm-hmm. And a lot of that goes to confidence. Because I think one of the single biggest things in social mobility is perhaps confidence. Mm-hmm. That you, and I make not shy away the very first thing I said, I didn't get into this firm to start with. Mm-hmm. Came from a very different background. People would expect, I didn't have the confidence. I absolutely crashed out at my interviews in 25 different organisations before I got a job. So it's a very personal driver for me in terms of making us more accessible and giving different people access to what we do.
Is that because your background has shaped that, do you think?
Or? Absolutely, yeah. So background, I was at a comprehensive school in Birmingham, and in terms of the sociability factors that take it, I'd be there. First person in my family to go to university.
Yeah, me too. And I think we need to talk about it more.
Absolutely.
We need to talk about it and say, actually, state school, you know, it's, and there is a confidence thing.
Huge.
And so thank you for sharing that. Appreciate it. We've got quite a lovely lot of questions coming in, but maybe I'd like to just get a little bit of colour, because, again, it always helps for people listening to say, well, it's all very well, but what do we do practically? And if you've been doing some really good stuff in terms of social mobility, let's put it like that, but in terms of refugees, what...
Yeah, I mean, absolutely. We've been doing, we've been focused on social mobility as a firm for a number of years now. So it has taken a while to mature in terms of the agenda, and it is very much linked to sustainability. So we work in tandem between our two teams, the sustainability team. They very much focus on what can we do in our outreach, what can we do for our schools that wouldn't normally, cold spot schools that wouldn't normally get the opportunity to come into a firm like ours or wouldn't have the confidence. And we've actually had a program where we've encouraged refugees to come to have some work experience to start with, to gain the confidence. We've taught them different skills in terms of working in professional services, like how to write a CV, the basic skills that you would expect to have gained yourself through a mainstream education just wasn't in existence. So what are the skills you need to prepare for an interview? I was talking to, I'm sure he won't mind me saying his name, I was talking to Vincent about this, and Vincent... the first time he actually saw the ability to get free water was when he came for an interview at Grant Thornton, and he sat in our lovely reception and had never experienced anything like that before. And imagine how intimidating that is for someone that's never had to wear a tie before, that's never experienced an office of this size, to then have to sit and do an interview and talk about yourself. So done a lot of pre-work and prep work to get people educated around that. And social diversity is huge. We don't talk about it, tend to be embarrassed about it, and we tend to hide it. And it's one of our biggest barriers to actually understanding it is that people choose to hide it. So getting people to talk about it, we had a group talking about it yesterday, and one of the partner in our firm had actually said, you know, for a long time, I didn't talk about my background, and my background was get your head down and deliver. Don't take risks, don't put your head above the parapet. And therefore, how do we expect people to therefore want to be promoted and want to put themselves forward for risks if that's their background? So it's understanding cultural heritage, where people come from, how can we link that into our understanding of inclusion?
Yeah, no, thank you. James Carter, Senior Risk Manager, Marsh, are the firms that are raising... Actually, I will go to this. Sorry, it slipped. No, let me just come back to the ESG question. James, I'll come back to your question. Andrew, Senior Compliance Officer, how important do you believe ESG professionals will soon require a seat at the C-suite table, as we're now seeing with some financial services firms, just to come back on the ESG?
ESG, well, I think one of the most sought-after sort of positions which are at the moment significantly rife in the recruitment market is heads of sustainability. That is getting to be a key sort of like ask from a lot of companies, and hence indicating how important sustainability is starting to become. And ultimately, you know, at the board level right now, the discussions on sustainability are very new. What do we ask? What do we really need to know? If we've got plans, how do we actually challenge that out? So absolutely, I do think that the individual will need to have an individual with knowledge on sustainability, you know, possibly a specialist, for example, non-executive director coming in with that knowledge base on the table.
Okay, we're going to do a bit of a quick fire now, because I've got so many questions coming in. I want to make sure that we get all of them covered. I'm going to go back to James and just... Oh, no, let's do James. James Carter, Senior Risk Manager, Marsh. Are the firms that are raising colleagues' wages due to cost of living increases the same firms that show the best behaviours in terms of D&I and ESG?
If I look at the people I speak to, those that do short-term lifts in pay, within 6, 9, 12 months, a lot of those people who joined them for short-term reasons are finding they don't fit and are moving. Mm. But it's such a war for talent. People are doing that and forgetting what really attracts and retains people. I think it's a very short-termist approach.
Anyone else want to pick up on that before I move on?
I need to agree.
Yeah. Well, then there's an anonymous one here saying, what advice would you give specifically to graduates? It's kind of off the back of that, who left university in the last 2 years, how to do career planning for the next 5 to 10 years. So maybe not go necessarily for the short fix, to really think and ask the questions of whether an organisation is for them, because that's going to enable their career to sustain, rather than thinking, actually, this is not the right environment for me. I don't know. What do you think?
Well, I've got a son who's 24, daughter who's 22, so it's a very pertinent thing. I'm probably, so I like Dave, actually, so I'm state school too, and have chips on both of my shoulders, which I'm trying to brush off as fast as I can. But I would have said, join a corporate and get in a grad scheme, and that used to be how I used to think. Mm. Actually, I've learned an awful lot through being around the exceptional bright people we've got in our clients and at Grant Thornton, is that that's not what excites younger people today. They want to work in a place that helps them develop, they have a real connection with, and whether that's a purpose or culture or whether it's the values. And quite frankly, find somewhere that makes you happy. So actually think less about the company and the sector. Start thinking about what kind of role, what kind of business would make me happy? What are the skills I've got, and make that connection between the two? So start with yourself, and with that, then think about, okay, so what might that mean for what roles and what sectors I could go for?
And how do you lose the chips and the imposter syndrome and all that comes with perhaps bringing, when we bring ourselves into a building?
I don't think you can lose it. I've got a big not good enough button. The first step.
But you've still made it.
Yeah, but the first step is knowing I've not got, or that I've got chips and got a not good enough button. And talking about it, to what Jen said, is that one thing in the last 3 or 5 years inside Grant Thornton is that we talk about things that you didn't normally talk about, and not just the partners talk or the grads talk, the business talks about this.
and being authentic and real, and just by telling the stories that people have, breaks down so many things.
And what about supporting people in their career development in that regard?
I was just about to add, actually, the absolute critical importance of allies. So when we talk about D&I, we talk a lot about allies and understanding different backgrounds, different perspectives. But also, if you're a person in power, so you've got the privilege, you've earned it, you're in a position of power to be able to influence someone else, what can you do to sponsor people's development, to actually help them to see their confidence? And I think about the most influential mentors in my life. They were the ones that said, you've got this. My immediate reaction, if I have a challenge or I have an opportunity, is to go, I can't do it, I'm not good enough. It's my immediate reaction. And I need people around me to say, you are good enough, you can do this. And I know that sounds bizarre given the place I am in my life. You'd think I'd have that cracked by now. But I don't. And I think it's having those people around you that can say you really do have this and they believe in you, and then that helps you to develop. So I think that's fundamentally so important to businesses to think in that way.
Paul Smith, CEO, how do you see building a stronger culture will be impacted by hybrid working?
I think it's a massive opportunity. So you think that the culture we've thrived and survived on since 2020, the start of lockdown, was built in a world which won't come back. It was all sort of lots of day-to-day stuff. We've probably had, I think, 1,500 people join a business of 5,000 since. Some have come from other places, some have come into the place of work for the very first time, so they don't look back so much. So we've got the opportunity to recreate that culture, but I think the word we keep giving to people is be intentional.
Exactly.
Don't just default office homes. Today I'm doing these tasks, they're best done at home. Tomorrow I want to collaborate with people. I've come into the office and there's been no one in. It's been a complete waste of time. I've come in to see people and it's been energy sparking, posting, all the things you used to do. So it's having that intention and really owning your own development.
Okay, so there's a question that's just come in then. Flexibility is key. Part-time remote working, regional working, combined work, caring or social activities. As a client-driven firm, how will GT achieve this?
Can I go again to start and then perhaps Jen can come in with a better answer? change of mindset. So we had a partners meeting face-to-face in September, which was just lovely to see everyone for the first time in 2 years. And to try and change people's mindset, we brought a surgeon in who shares his job because his shift ends and someone else will come in and take care of the patient who won't die. So try and get our partners thinking.
Absolutely.
We do some really important work for clients, but it's not life and death, let's be honest. We can have a different mindset, be more flexible. We don't have to see people. We don't have to be the only person at the end of the phone. We can take time off. We can visibly take time off. We can put in our diaries, I'm going home to be at the children's parents' evening, rather than keep it as private and don't tell anyone like we used to. It's just been more open, but having a different mindset about your own importance at times.
Mm. We were talking earlier about the challenge of burnout and tiredness. Yeah. If we can really start to think about flexibility as a way of working, not just in hours work, but in terms of the job, you know, you're not the only person responsible. So at the moment, we have one person who's able to sign off a job in audit. Now, that puts a huge amount of pressure on that individual, and there's one point of failure. So if we're starting to work in a more collaborative way, we bring a digitalisation, what's to stop us starting to challenge these old norms, to say, well, why is that the case? And actually, could we break down the responsibilities? And having different, better ways of working will enable us to do that, which I think in turn will allow people who work part-time to feel that they are equally as valued and doing a great job. Whereas at the moment, it feels a bit like if you're full-time, you're in and you're getting all the opportunities. And if you're part-time, you're not quite. And so it's trying to equalise all that with ways of working and process and productivity. I think that's also important.
And then, go on.
No, and if I look at my clients in a perverse way, so look, the last 2 years, and lots of firms can't work remotely, so there are a range and type of firms. But those roles and those jobs and those firms who can, it's been forced upon them. But actually, the productivity in most of the clients I speak to has gone up.
Yeah.
We spoke before about the increase in trust, increase in transparency of leadership, probably greater bonds built in quite strange ways. Just seeing people's rooms and their homes, it builds a different kind of relationship. It's not always the one we want, because seeing people face-to-face is really important. I think it comes back to Dave's point and to the question there is the culture bit, is that intentionally now, it's been forced upon us. So as we start to work out what it means for us in our business across the next year, having that intentional planning and thinking, retaining the increase in the productivity, retaining how flexible we can be to a work day, and making sure we do job shares and bringing in all the talent we've never allowed ourselves to access because that's not how we work. Actually, intentional thinking to that and the impact on culture and behaviours, massive, but links to the war on talent too. So how do we do it, not just about reward? That's how we do it, not just about reward.
And I wonder, because we've had this period, that people are also, you talk, everyone's been talking about the energy of coming into London, you know, being here. People will be thirsty to upskill, they'll be thirsty to progress, they've been asking questions, you know, what is my purpose, what am I doing, you know, what people are going to be thirsty. And there's a question here, what are the risks if we fail to cover the skills gaps?
Well, in terms
it's pretty obvious,
of GDP,
I guess,
but quite frankly, I mean, we've seen it in the stats that came out in Q4 of last year. It's going to really suppress, as a whole economy, our GDP. Mm. It will not allow us to achieve the very real opportunities we see, but also other firms will. Mm-hmm. So actually, your greatest risk is you may not, as an organisation, but your competitor who gets this right will.
Yeah, I saw a lovely summary when I was sort of thinking about power shift, and I was just doing a bit of research for this, and someone had said, you know, things have shifted. Organisations to people, profit to purpose, me to we. People are asking themselves more questions than ever of where they work and what they're doing. So I did like that as a thought. We need to
come in on the productivity point, because I think that's a point for the UK as a whole. Mm. I know 2 or 3 years ago, the government was looking at huge investment, particularly in the SME, the smaller business, to increase productivity. So I think as a UK economy, we have to grasp that, particularly in a world post-Brexit where there's even more need to have more skills in this, because we have a skills gap, we will have a real problem.
But there's a number of questions, and I'm going to try and group them together with concerns, I think, really, about the impact. We've got one here, does driving the ESG agenda mean sacrificing company returns? So is there a compromise, you know, given the challenges, is ESG, the agenda, going to mean sacrificing company returns? And also, if I loop this in, Sonia, I'm going to come to you, but then to everybody. Alex Nicholson, FD Rocket Food, what government policies do the panel predict will have the biggest impact, both positive and detrimental, to businesses and their workforce in 2022? And there's a few in terms of sort of the ESG maybe being sort of a less than positive. So I don't know, Sonia, first to you on that.
So, I mean, in terms of statistics and research, the ESG investments actually have performed very, very well during the pandemic. But I think it does need to be borne in mind that, you know, this whole ESG, it's basically what firms need to start thinking long-term and the long-term success of that organization. So in instances where a lot of firms will need to invest quite a bit on ESG, understand what they need to invest in and invest in, of course, that's actually going to impact on your bottom line. But what firms are starting to think is looking at the long-term returns. So the long-term returns and what they're seeing is actually there. Alongside with that is the short-term gains, where a lot of companies are moving forward on the sustainability platform, is that in order to be competitive, remain competitive, and also attract talent, as we're saying, that's going to be crucial for you to be seeing into the long-term survival and success of that firm as well.
Mm. Kate, can I come in on that? Because there is a big commercial paradox in there. We could get to net zero very quickly if we all stayed at home and didn't meet each other.
Yeah.
So take a business opportunity, if it's overseas and you're competing with someone, as that you perceive that team are going to fly out, do you fly out or not? Because there's a real carbon cost to flying
out.
So you might miss the opportunity. It's going to change every time, because actually you've got to put yourself in the mindset of the buyer, the client. The client may think, actually, these people are taking climate a bit more seriously. They're doing it online because we will be part of their supply chain. We will be part of their scope 3 emissions. depending which part of the world you're in, as the world gets to the same position.
So how do we empower people to make those decisions? And that includes hybrid working. You know, if I'm coming in, am I part of the problem? You know, if I don't come in, then maybe I'm going to be the problem because I'm not in.
I think it's awareness and education, and an idea toying in my head, which as CFO and CEO, I think, don't go there, is we have monetary budgets. How far away are we from carbon budgets in terms of, look at Al, there's your BC team, there's your carbon budget for the next 2 years.
Yeah.
That's for your discretion to spend and make informed choices. Yeah. We're not there yet, but if we could get there, that would be a different way to run a business. Mm-hmm. My partners are probably thinking, no.
Yeah, well, what about the government policies that might drive change?
I think the biggest one's going to be, there's one that's going to affect us. There's a white paper coming on audit reform, which is going to affect our business, and there'll be a knock-on effect on lots of our clients in terms of the way they buy professional services and what they do. But I think more broadly, it is going to be around ESG.
I think the one that I'd add is the government, in terms of the policies they got in, have been put on the shelf while they're dealing with the pandemic. As we come through that, through Q1, Q2, second half, leading up to the next elections, they have to start to deliver on the levelling up agenda. So I think the other agendas are around the political agendas that are going to hit and where the government choose to invest and enact and deliver against the policies they've set.
Thanks, Alex, for that. We've got a few more coming in. I'm aware of the time, and I want to just open up to get your final thoughts for things that we may have not covered. But just so three last ones, just to make sure that I have covered all those. You've still got time to send a few more in, but how do you develop a global approach to ESG, which we've just touched upon? So you might want to just pick up on that quickly, Dave. But to what extent will supply chain issues impact the operational resilience of UK financial services firms? That's something that we haven't really touched upon. So to what extent will supply chain issues impact the operational resilience of UK financial services firms? And then I've got a final one on ESG, but I think that the supply chain issue is obviously a biggie, isn't it?
It's a massive one. So what did we see last year our clients doing, and what did we advise them on is, A, how do I squeeze my supply chain as much as I can because there's a shortage here based on skills or based on chips or based on global demand. The thematic we're seeing is more local supply chains. And actually, it's where that duality of what's right for the business, but from an ESG perspective too, is driving that. So nearshoring or bringing work back on, or production, having local companies who can respond fast, understand my market, they understand my needs. I think there's going to be a massive shift, which then moves into supply chain finance. So from a financial services perspective, that will be for business in terms of the Opt model, the supply chain. It's going to be a big area of change in the course of this year.
Mm. And in terms of future-proofing, another one on ESG, is a lot of them on ESG. How do you build an ESG framework that is future-proof for tomorrow's economic realities? That's another big one for you to leave there.
Yeah. I think today, everything on ESG is... we still got to classify it. It is a lot of unknowns out there. There's a lot we're not aware of. So around when you've determined your ESG framework, I think keeping it quite fluid, adaptable, resilient as well, and you know, make it innovative to what you are able to change it to. The more information we obtain, the more data which comes in into where you need to be. So I think you do need to allow it for flexibility around your framework. Of course, having the dialogue, but also I think sitting around with your industry peers, comparing your notes, setting the standards will help you to future-proof your ESG agenda.
And Jen, in terms of purpose, what can we put in place in the operating model to highlight that we're serious about R&D?
I think there's an awful lot you can do, and I think it's small steps, and it will be a bit like how we approach ESG. It will be small steps to start with, but it's things like how are we listening to our people, first of all? So what sentiment surveys are we using from an operational point of view? Do we have a really robust whistleblowing line in place, and are we taking that seriously, for example? How are we approaching hybrid working? Are we really clear about what that looks like, and are people confident in our approach to that, so that they know where the boundaries are and that they're able to work within those? And also things like, could be small steps, like how inclusive are your hybrid meetings, and when are you choosing to use the space to connect with each other in the office versus what you're doing externally. And actually, from an operational point of view, what are you putting in place that demonstrates your actions in terms of being really clear that you care from a mental health point of view as well? So I think that...
And what does that look like? How can you show that?
I think there are... I think I touched on it before. It's your actions of your leaders. So if they're serious about mental health, they're pushing it through the organisation. So I think the things that are coming are, you know, a real focus on psychological well-being, a real focus on physical health, and taking the time and the approach to enable that to happen, ensuring that people's financial well-being is looked after. From you know, there'll be much more people in debt than there ever has been, even though the pandemic is showing a polarisation in wealth and where that's been focused. And then I think there'll be a real push around social culture from a well-being point of view. And what is your business putting in place, both to protect your own safety, and do I feel safe within that organisation? And also, do I feel socially connected to people, whether that be through new apps or face-to-face interactions or other ways?
It's interesting you pick up on those two points, actually, because what we know from neuroscience is that if we don't, I'm pointing to this part of the brain, which is the most primitive part of the brain, but, you know, if, and we've all, it's all been targeted because of the past year with fear. So if we are in a place of fear and we're operating from a lack of social sort of connectedness, that's the part of their brain that's going to be trumping all the time the cortical thinking, which is driving the much more measured, wise thinking is that we all need to get back to. We've all been living in a much more sort of fearful lack of social place. So our limbic system, we're operating from a place that is less cortical. And I think understanding that we do need a bit of just a coming back to calm, that people need to feel safe and connected, yeah. Then we can start making the big decisions. And I think that's probably what I was thinking about when you were talking about that tired place, because we just need to let that dust really settle before we can move forward. We're coming to a close. We've covered a lot of ground, but as always, it's kind of drilling in. I'd like to just give you each an opportunity to address everybody who's watching, is what are your last thoughts that we need to take away as we look forward to the year ahead? So just to give you a beat and time to think, but your personal last thoughts were the most sort of one or two most important points that you'd like people to maybe consider, having heard what we've said today.
I think it's the role of leaders. So if we look at how to deal with inflation, supply chain and technology investment, I think most leaders have a well-trodden path around that. It's still a challenge, but it's a well-trodden path. Around some of the topics we've spoken about today, inclusion and diversity and DSG, and the way we work going forward, these are less well-trodden paths for leaders. And so the one thing that we're doing with my team, with clients, is almost holding that mirror up, doing a maturity assessment around how leaders think about inclusion and diversity and ESG, and helping them set real plans. Because actually, there are whole areas of this agenda that our leaders don't have the skills because it's not been asked before. And so they're looking for peers and help in where am I, where do I need to get to? And as you keep saying, Kate, is what are the practical steps to get there?
And I think leading on to the fact that, yes, leaders are, you know, this whole ESG and sustainability, a lot of language being used, a lot of acronyms being thrown up, shying away from that. And what I'd say is that, you know, it is a journey, and I don't think it should be taken that it's an overnight fix and it will be done. But embracing the journey, but also being transparent about what you can achieve, what your plans are to be achieved, and just being honest, you know, in terms of if you have not been able to achieve something or you don't have the information but wish to get there, being very transparent. I think that gains the trust of everyone, all your stakeholders around that.
And to be minded and prepared to be accountable as well.
Absolutely.
In that regard.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Yes.
Thank you very much, Sonia.
I would say invest in the ability to give yourself and leaders courage. There are still a number of unknowns, even though we're heading more into known territory. There are a number of unknowns around how we deal with I&D, how we respond to ESG, and it will be the actions that we choose to take, and it's the small steps. So it's the where do we start and then how do we take it forward? But I think overall it's about investing time investment in understanding your own cognitive bias and understanding the bias within your organisation and then putting steps in place to educate yourself around what you can do as an individual first and then what others can do around you.
Mm. Came into this thinking we'd have a conversation about ESG. Surprised maybe I shouldn't be just how much conversation about ESG. Just how important that is to get right, to seize the opportunities where we started. Because if we don't, we'll miss them. Our clients want it, our people want it. I think it's just the right thing to do, which defines how we want to be.
Thank you. I'll just quickly say, before I'm going to hand Alan, if you've got a few more points I think you'd like to sum up. If there are any other questions, I've covered all of the ones that I've seen so far and that we've had time for, but you can still send some questions in and we'll keep those on and get responses to you. There will be a recording of this that will be made available. And just from me to say thank you so much for watching. I'm going to hand to Alan now for a final few thoughts, but thank you so much. And here's to a good year ahead, Alan.
Brilliant. And we've touched upon a lot of really important things today. There is a real level, though, of confidence and optimism about the year ahead. There are clearly lots of things that firms have to face off into. And being leaders, it can be quite a lonely role. But just feel rest assured, though, that there's a whole community who are struggling with and working through it and making real success across these same things. So look, post this, if there are any themes or topics you'd like to explore more, then we can connect you with real things that people are doing to make a real difference across what are some really important agendas and topics. Thank you.
Thank you.